Now, if you've been listening to pop icons from the past on platforms including Spotify, Apple Music or Amazon Music, there's a good chance that you have one Media IP to thank for it. The digital content provider acquires nostalgic music and television programs from bands, producers and record labels and digitises them, making them fit for 21st century consumption. Well, I am very pleased today to welcome the chairman and CEO of the company, Michael Infante. Hello, Michael.
Good morning.
It's a real pleasure talking to you, Michael.
Thank you.
What an interesting company. One Media IP is basically a company that gets music from all the generations and make it up to speed with modern tastes or modern consumption.
Yeah, that's right. We started 10 years ago by listing on the OFX market. We raised money at that point to buy content. We've continued that content acquisition trail now for some, well, 10, nearly 11 years. Currently just short of £5.5 million invested in content. We have 250,000 music tracks across all genres and types of music in the library, and about 12,000 individual programmes for video that we've been acquiring since 2012, which are primarily marketed through YouTube and other licensed sources that we work with, trusted sources that we're working with. So our job is to acquire at the right price content, archive content from the 1960s, 70s, 80s and 90s. Video is about the same, although video now, we're moving up the scale and we're buying product from the 90s through to the 2000s. Our acquisition of Mena Motors from Granada ITV put that straight. We've recently just acquired the, under license for management, the Rediffusion, Associated Rediffusion catalogue, which a lot of it hasn't been seen for 50 or 60 years, some great archive material that we'll be bringing to a YouTube channel soon. And our job is really just to monetize that content in the best possible way.
Okay, Michael, so can you give us examples of successful artists or TV shows you've got in your portfolio? What are the best sellers and the big hitters?
Okay. When it comes to audio, we have a very broad spread of artists that we work with. We're working with the greats, literally, from the 60s, the 70s and the 80s. Everyone from Mungo Jerry to the Troggs to a variety of country and Western artists. We have a huge classical catalogue, probably one of the largest working classical catalogues under the Point Classics label, some 4,500 classical tracks and movements. When it comes to video, then we're working with the Mena Motors brand, which is a very, very popular brand for us. We launched that onto YouTube, having bought it from Granada ITV in 2012. That's now achieving 450,000 hits on our YouTube channel and has over 55,000 subscribers. On that point, we're looking at relaunching Mena Motors as a broadcast format for 2017, and we're in discussions to see how we take that forward. It's a very exciting time. Other TV shows that we would have YouTube channels for, things like Alien Autopsy, we have Sooty and Sweep, we have Skippy the Bush Kangaroo, we have collections of One Media Music, which is archive footage from probably the 1970s through to the 1990s, some 2,000 music tracks available on our channels. And again, the Ian Levine channel, which is nearly 3,000 Motown re-recorded hits taken from the 1980s. All of these are generating up to 1.3, 1.4 billion hits now on YouTube for us.
So a huge portfolio, and it seems that there is a lot of appetite out there for artists and TV shows and programmes of the past. How big is the market?
It's interesting because obviously as people become more technically savvy and they're tuning to other mediums than regular broadcasts, we're seeing the YouTube figures now really generate and grow. I mean, YouTube dominate that space. I mean, there are other sites and there are other Vevo and Vimeo and sites that people would go to. They tend to be more targeted at sort of frontline music. When you're talking about nostalgia, we're talking probably people age groups from 30 to sort of 55 who are now very technical savvy. They'll have smart TVs, they'll have their iPads. It's quite a large sector of the market. I think probably about 45% of the market would be looking at the nostalgic areas more than the frontline areas.
And you've just alluded to the fact that the way we consume music now is very different, isn't it, from only 10, 15 years ago. You used to walk into a shop, buy a CD, before that, a disc, I suppose. So buy a CD, then to the downloading model, I suppose, and now it's all about streaming, isn't it? So take us through the changes the industry has seen.
The model's changed from probably 2002, if we just look back to that turning point when the iPod was invented. The iPod came out and it revolutionised the way that we consume music. I don't think anybody really realised what we were looking at back then. In 2008, when the iPhone was launched, it changed again because you were liberated from your computer of just downloading tracks to a static device to then being able to stream and download on the go. So we saw the collapse of the CD probably hit the industry between 2004 and 2010. We're now seeing the collapse of downloading the iTunes model in favour of streaming as people make the second format transitional change. This is going to affect the industry globally as more and more channels that open, the Spotify stores, the Deezers, the way that Amazon have opened their streaming store, iTunes have now opened Apple Music, begin to dominate and people begin to just consume music either on a subscription basis or on a freemium basis, it's become known, where they then tolerate advertising. So the process of actually buying and owning is changing very much to a rental or leasing of music as the way people consumer habits change.
And you work with all these platforms you mentioned, that's Spotify, Deezer, you work with them all. Tell us about how this shift we have seen in the music industry and the way we consume music has changed your own business model.
Well, we have to manage the curve. We're using an expression that we like to get ahead of the digital curve, but quite frankly, the industry has to manage the curve at the moment because I think the whole industry saw an appreciable growth in digital downloading for the first 8 years. So from 2004, 2005, we saw a decent growth. I think as the industry is now changing and consumer demands are very, very different, that there's going to be effectively a fall off in digital downloading, an increase, and over the next 2 to 3 years will benefit the industry, but we have to manage this curve as one of the downloading drops off and streaming picks up. Streaming isn't picking up the income revenue model as fast as downloading is losing it at the moment. So there is this transitional period that we have to manage. We saw the same 10 years ago as CD dropped off and digital was picking up the business. CD fell off much faster than the digital model of iTunes picked up the curve. The film industry has to manage it as well. We're going to see the fall off of DVD in favour of streaming and VOD and all the different methods that we now consume our video requirements.
And is that why your revenue and your profitability in 2015 was not as good as previous years? Because you are in a transition period currently.
The transition has definitely contributed to a drop in our revenue. No two ways about it. We maintain margin, which is fine. You know, if I was sitting here not maintaining margin, I'd be very upset. We're maintaining our customer contact in terms of the ability to download to stores. So there's no let off in the number of streams. That's increasing. But of course, the revenue model, as I say, from digital downloading, where we got paid 79p in the UK model for a download from iTunes, now changing to a portion of the subscription that we get from the streaming model.
And are you confident you will be able to capture all the new market opportunities?
Well, the market for music has never changed. People's appetite for taking music is the same. It's how you deliver it. So there are two things that we're doing to change the way that we get ahead of the digital curve. One is our exploitation of our catalogue, and we have in excess of £5.5 million invested so far in content. We've only directed that so far through the traditional outlets we would call traditional of streaming and digital. We're now attacking very aggressively a what we call neighbouring rights model, which means that we'll be using our content to start marketing to advertisers, to other than digital outlets. This is something that traditionally the music industry has done. We've just been focused on a digital model, so we're now looking at re-exploitation of product through other avenues. That in itself is very exciting. It means that we have brands that we can now market. We have a huge catalogue, as I've mentioned, 250,000 music tracks and over 10,000-12,000 video programmes that have secondary uses.
And in terms of your strategy going forward, you've mentioned some of the ways you are going to adapt to the new market needs and the way we consume music now. Do you also intend to make acquisitions, for instance?
We're keeping a careful eye on acquisitions. The value of content has, without a shadow of a doubt, dropped off a little bit over the transitional period. So we keep a watchful eye on that. We don't want to overpay for content because obviously our payback then takes a lot longer. Several of our new initiatives, and we'll touch briefly on the two or three most important ones. The Point Classics acquisition we made of this very large classical catalogue. We're working with, as I said, non-traditional outlets to start getting that used in a lot more TV commercials, advertising campaigns, and a variety of background music for websites and radio productions. That's an initiative that we've only just started. We're working with our Men & Motors program to get that, as I said earlier, to get the brand back up and get it broadcast. It's receiving an awful lot of hits on our YouTube channels, and that's doing well. We also have something new for us, which is copyright enforcement is very important, and policing the rights is a very important part of what we do. We've developed something called TCAT, which stands for the Technical Copyright Analysis Tool. This is a service we've deployed across our own catalogue for the last 9-10 months. We're now offering that out as a third-party service to other record labels, and we have trials going on at the moment. So we expect that to be a service that One Media hasn't normally been associated with as a technical service, but it's something that we're terribly experienced in operating for our own use, and now we're able to offer that as a third-party use. So this is all part and package of re-strategising how we use both our skill sets and our content.
And the beauty is you have the cash you need to make further acquisitions or support the changes you're going to implement.
Indeed. I mean, our share price has been hit lately, and I'm really not surprised by that. I think at the moment we're a real bargain. If you just look at the capital asset of the business, you know, it's way under the market cap that the exchange puts on us. What we're able to do from the initial resources that we have is not look for any additional funding. We don't need any working capital. We're well resourced in that direction. So we're able to carry out our new strategy as we move forward without going back to shareholders.
Well, Michael, what a fascinating conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Michael Infante, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer at One Media IP.